What? Sorry, Eugene, you only just learnt that. I have not touched some communal nuts in about 10, 15 years. Like, people think it's... I use a crew to avoid the checkpoints for efficiency and speed. It's just because if I'm not there first, I don't want to put my hand in those Harry bow.
Kia ora tato. That was Robbie Britton. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
This is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners.
Hey, you can do lockdown loops as a Wild Things challenge now.
So, look, it's been a couple of weeks and we're a bit... It's good that we've got new stuff to talk about in the ads. What's a lock... I mean, I think I have an understanding of what a lockdown loop is, but now there's a challenge. Can you explain that to me?
Yeah. So you just clock up any loop or out and back run within the Auckland lockdown region, and this is like geo-locked in, and you're in with the chance to grab Wild Things prize worth $198.
That's an oddly specific amount of money.
Well, it's good. It's good. You know, you know what you're aiming for. You know,
and
you
200.
Can do things like you can post photos as well, which summarizes your running in lockdown. If you post them to Instagram and use the hashtag Wild Things Lockdown, you can get $50 bucks to spend in the Wild Things shop.
Nice.
You know, and this is all if you are a VIP member. Which now. To become a VIP member with some extra, what you do is you use the code DCR2021 and that gets you 15 months for the price of 12.
Right.
And it works
Rob's
out.
Everyone's
happy. Rob's happy.
We're happy.
You're happy because you get your extra 3 months for free.
Access to all the benefits of the Wild Things store.
Yeah.
And chance to go in the draw for $198, not a $200, not $195.
That's not a draw. That's if you win the lockdown loop challenge, you know?
How do you win
But
it?
Actually, the thing is too, Rob, since taking over the Wild Things thing, he's had a look at the way that the challenges work, and he's added a really clear summary of how they do work. So if you want to check that out, go to have a look at wildthings.club and search about wild challenges, and you can find a really good explanation of it. You can also, while you're there, go and use the old store, get your discount, make use of the library. I think the library's moved from Mal and Sal's place to Rob's now.
Cool.
That's how it works. Wild Things Library. But yeah, all those benefits of being a VIP member of Wild Things. Do it.
I'm DCR intrigued.
2021.
Yeah. This has been dragging on a bit. Not just these ads. However, the current situation that we're all going through. And one of the... I am appreciating simple joys. And one of the things that I appreciate is my Ultra Spire Zygos 4 vest. I can't speak highly about it enough. I wore it this morning. I loved it when I got it. I love it now. If you go to ultraspire.co.nz, check out their range of packs. And they have been a supporter of the show since day one. So please, you know, go show them some love. We'd really appreciate it. It helps them out. And
show
we
them
feel
some
all the
love.
Better.
And you get some love as well, because you'll have something to love. Your Zygos 4, you will love it.
Any number of the waist lights. They're just Ultra Spire, just a fantastic company. And been in it with us from day one. So if you go to ultraspire.co.nz and check out the range of packs they've got there, you won't be disappointed.
Mm. Tell you how else to not be disappointed.
How?
Check out Further Faster.
Yeah,
if
Further
you're
Faster.
Ōtautahi, Christchurch, get along to the store. But if you're not, jump on the website, furtherfaster.co.nz. Have a look at all the goodies that they sell. So many good things.
Go on Instagram and have a look. They're running a Auckland-specific challenge for us. Those of us who, you know, perhaps our adventuring has been curtailed slightly, go check out the details on their Instagram. And just a fantastic group of people. They are knowledgeable. They are, we both got some jackets the other day, and we were saying, you know, we gave them a list of requirements, and they really did kind of tailor what we wanted. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, we got just the ticket for both of us, really. So. Mm.
So knowledgeable, so involved in the community, and they, you know, they give back in so many different ways, yeah. Don't they? So, you know, support those who support others, I guess.
And go something like further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jack is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Oh, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jack is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Church Radio. Episode 163.
It's been a minute.
Yeah.
But we made it.
We made it. Week off last week.
Yeah, week off last week. And I have to say, you know, thank you, Eugene, for holding it down in my absence the week before.
Well, yeah. I mean, I missed you then, and we missed each other last week, didn't we? Got a few people missed us too. I got a couple of panicked messages at 6 a.m. going, the upload, the feed hasn't updated. What's up?
Well, like, but, and this is the thing, I guess. Sorry about that. There's nothing more dramatic than we just both really needed a bit of a rest.
Yeah.
Yeah. it's been a couple of months, isn't it? it's been a couple of months for both of us. I liked, I don't know if you watched the Billy Yang film about Anton Krupichka.
Oh, I haven't watched it yet.
It's really good.
Yeah.
It's really, really good. And at the end, Anton Krupichka says, I listen to music that is really loud and discordant, and it's quite chaotic, and it feels like at any moment it could just kind of fall apart. Mm. And that's what running an ultramarathon is like. And that's basically how, I don't want to speak for you, but that's how kind of my life's felt over the last couple of months. So it was just nice to get a bit of a break.
Yeah. So we took a week off, but boy, we've come back with a flyer.
Yeah. Robbie Britton. Guest,
but man, I loved again, having a chat to him.
I mean, for those of you who don't know, it was about a year ago. Well, it was March last year, during first lockdown, when we spoke to Robbie. You know, he is a world and European bronze medalist in the 24-hour distance, you know, personal best of 261 kilometers, 229 marathon. He's got a master's in science. He's a, you know, he's a renowned coach. And now he's an author.
Is there anything he doesn't do, that guy? A book called
1001 Running Tips, The Essential Runner's Guide. And we had an incredible conversation with him.
We did. We checked in with him in Northern Italy just after he'd finished a 6-hour race last week, and just before he heads off to ride an amazing race in Italy. Living life.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And please, you know, enjoy the conversation. And if you want to take part in our little our sweepstake about guess the podcast host, please, you know, you can send a stamped self-addressed envelope to us at Dirt Church Acres, and the winner will be drawn next podcast. But how have you been, man?
I've been okay. I needed that week off. Things got a bit hectic, but yeah, it's been good. I've been getting into the 24-hour training, which is that strange situation of training for a race that you're not sure is actually going to happen. But of course you have to keep training, because, you know, A, I'm enjoying it, but B, also if they don't call it off and you haven't trained, that's going to be a bit embarrassing. So that's been a bit weird, but it's been going okay. Family's been going good. We had the picnics restriction, availed ourselves of that to catch up with wee Dan, the grandson, yesterday, which was good. So that was nice. Enjoyed that. But how about you?
I mean, yeah, same. Needed the week off, and I'm in the same boat as you. I'm certainly not training for a 24-hour race, but training for Kepler. And again, you know, and not to put the mockers on it, but with a reasonable apprehension that certainly me being from Auckland, that I won't be traveling.
It's tough, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a tough one. But I think training for life is really important at the moment. So absolutely. Enjoy. I've been running on the roads exclusively until yesterday, as we're recording, when we got a chance to see each other for the first time.
How good was that?
8 weeks and run up hills and do all that cool stuff. And yeah, work's busier than ever. I got, as I was just saying to you, my phone went as I got into the car yesterday. I was on call and I ended up being in, you know, back to work for all day.
Yeah, we went for a run together in the forest, our first one that we've been able to go together. You know, we did it safely and so on. First one together for a couple of months. And then by the time I got home, I had to pick something up on the way home. By the time I got home, Matt has texted me Nick Minute photo of himself in scrubs back in at the hospital with the mask and everything. I don't think that's in the recovery textbook. Maybe it's in Robbie's 1001 tips.
I don't think it is, but it was really amazing that I got to see you and we did have that good run. It really set me up for the week. And what was amazing, I went for my long run this morning and I saw the most incredible rainbow, which I know I don't normally get into stuff like that, but this incredible rainbow.
Yeah.
And I posted it on our Instagram, on the Dirt Chitrady Instagram. And B, I almost had this, because I was on call, so I was doing loops of a ridge where there's cell phone reception all the time. And as I dropped down to run home, I spent like a kilometre running with this other runner, socially distanced, of course, and just really lovely to share with another human being. You know, he was from Mission Bay. He'd come out to Riverhead. You know, he said he felt safer out in Riverhead than he did in Mission Bay. And just a nice, nice guy, just kind of doing his best to get through. It was quite lovely to have that sort of human connection. So doing all right.
Very good. All right. Well, let's hit this button. Stuff you should know. Stuff you should know.
Did you know we got an email from someone saying, what's that noise
that you play?
Yeah, and I had to it's Andrew McDowell and his ukulele saying stuff you should know.
Yeah.
Yeah, first time we've had to
clarify. I thought it was quite clear.
Yeah.
Clear. Anyway.
There we go. It's called a malaprop when you, you know, it's like, excuse me while I kiss this guy or, you know.
Oh, okay. Right. Yeah. Anyway, a few updates. Stephen Redfern, who was on episode 151, he's over in Sydney. He did a solo 6-day run, and we talked about this a couple of weeks ago when we did the show. So he was running from Saturday the 25th of September to Thursday the 30th of September, and he was doing it because he had aimed for a six-day race that he couldn't get to, and so he thought, gosh darn, do it myself. So he ended up running for 16 hours a day, which is when the track was open, from 5 a.m. until 9 p.m. each day. And for the 6 days, he got a total of 655.18 kilometres.
Wow. Actual running time of 96 hours. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
And he says here, the total time when I started the watch to when I stopped the watch being 136 hours. Goodness.
And I was reading his race report too, and the poor guy, you know, he wasn't sleeping much on those nights in between either because it was taking so long for his, you know, his legs would just be aching. So massive, massive effort, Stephen, and doing that on your own. Wow. Hazel Harrison too.
So she ran the
trail runner.
Yeah, she went and ran the marathon to Sadler.
Yeah,
250 kilometers. Well, as if people know what that is, it's a 250 kilometer stage race in the Sahara Desert. And we got Kate Shave came through with an excellent update.
She was providing them each day. It was brilliant. Yeah,
she was. Hazel, fifth in her age group, 20th woman out of 125 original starters, and 163rd overall out of 640 starters.
Yeah.
That's amazing. She was raising money for melanoma NZ, and in 2019 she was diagnosed with stage 3 melanoma.
Mm.
My goodness me. I mean, well done, Hazel. And we'll
amazing.
Put a link to to her fundraising page in the show notes.
Yes, let's do that. And look, we've also been talking for the last couple of weeks about Harita Davis of Christchurch, who's running in the Sri Shimnoi Trough's Self-Transcendence 3,100-mile race in New York City. I'd just like to say too, we're not all about ultra running, but
not
just
at all.
Happens that her updates are just this week about ultra running, but hey, we're all about the short races as well. But anyway, Harita is doing amazing stuff over there in New York. So upon completion of this year's race, she'll hold the second greatest amount of finishes for any woman in history and remain the eighth woman to ever complete the race. She set a PB for 2,000 miles. What's your 2,000 mile PB again, Matt? I can't remember off the top of my head. Anyway, she ran
44 years. How old am I? I'm 44. Yeah, 44 years.
Yeah. All right. So Harita, 32 days, 12 hours, 54 minutes, 24 seconds, 2,000 mile PB. Day 34 as we record, and she's run 3,445 kilometres. Week five. So that's day 34 of, she's got 52 days to do the 3,100 miles, which is 4,989 kilometres. So well over halfway now. And she's in fourth place. Amazing. Keep it up.
Do you
that
think
sounds a silly
point...
thing to say, doesn't it? Keep it up.
Hey, good. Well done.
Well done. Not far to go now.
Oh, do you need, I bet your knees get, look, I couldn't even drive that far. Well, you actually couldn't. Because it's
you
like,
couldn't. Yeah.
Three, that's like, that's nearly... You could go from the, surely you could go from like Cape Reinga, Stewart Island, back up again.
What's Te Araroa? Yeah.
Anyway. Yeah, so anywho, right, it's okay. A lot, it's a long freaking way.
She's amazing. Okay, let's do this.
Greatest run ever.
We would have had a race bit, but you know, no races. But greatest run ever is the part of the show. It's intensely popular part of our show where we ask you to write into us and tell us about your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or a mountain summit. It might just be a run around the block, something that's sung to you for some reason. Please send them in to us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. Now, this one is from Sarah Cravanger from the mighty Waikato. I'd lost my groove. The last 2 weeks have been an emotional blur with the passing of two of my nanas, 3 days apart, then also our dear friend's nana passing. Unexpected car bills, 3 vet call-outs during lambing season for 1U. On our lifestyle block, I felt like I was dragging the chain even with a few small runs here and there. I just felt emotionally and physically drained. Then came the announcement of level 4 lockdown. As a mum of 3 and a wife working within our business, I knew what needed to be done once again. That's a lot. Yeah. Not to reduce it. As I fast forward to day 5 of lockdown, I wander out into the kitchen in my dressing gown, thinking about breakfast. My phone buzzes. It's a dear running friend sending me a picture with the caption, "I've almost run to your house." Wow, damn. With a quick reply, checking to see if she was all good and needing anything to be placed at the mailbox for her, i.e. water, she messages back to say she's all good and would message me when she finished. She finally contacts back with details on the 14K loop she completed. Throughout the day, it pondered on my mind how I needed to get out there again. And with that note, my mind was set. That night, I set out my running gear and placed my pack and run gloves on the kitchen table, checked the details of the loop, and then headed to bed. That morning, I was up before the alarm, knowing what I had to achieve for the day. Run, schooling, work, and AG day animals with the kids. As I geared up, warmed up, and flicked a quick birthday text to my mum and headed out the door. As the first 3.5Ks was down a road I'd experienced many times before, I knew what was expected. As the sun was breaking over Mount Maungatauturi in front of me, I felt blessed to be able to experience the beautiful sunrise. As I continued, I could hear the quiet rumble of the main road, normally buzzing with busy vehicles going to and from work. I crossed the road and headed into unknown running territory for me. Rolling hills, heritage church, and active farm life all around. 8Ks in, with a slightly tight right quad muscle due to missing my physio appointment for my right hamstring that I ruptured nearly 3 years ago during a trial running event. God, this woman is a Spartan. My goodness me. Which required surgery and a long recovery. Come on now. As I slow down the pace and slightly rubbing out the tightness within my quad, I head onto a track which we used for our summer 5K running loop with my local running club, the Roadrunners Mount Perongia, and Kakapuku stood proudly in the forescape surrounded by the morning blue sky. As I ran towards a now sleepy country town, my watch buzzed, 12 kilometres. As I looked up and smiled to myself, I'm feeling great, no more than great, fantastic. I pass the normally lively local sports ground and headed into the sculpture park. As I dive around the bends, of the town, I head out the final stretch back out into the rural country for home. As I take in the last few Ks, time to think and look back on what has happened over the last few weeks, the memories and good times with the kids and nanas, and how life can catch you up in the blink of an eye. I turn into my road for home. On the last small but mighty hill, I put my head down and do that final push. As I reach the top, there it is, home. Quiet but peaceful for now. What a run. It was nothing impressive, but to me, it is what I needed. The country air, time for me to prepare and get back into life in the day ahead.
Sarah, wow.
So
that was...
Yeah, I mean, I don't have my for your loss.
Mm.
And well done. I think anyone who even gets out the door in the current... It feels, it's psychologically, it's like doing everything with oven mitts on, I reckon, at the moment. Yeah,
well, getting out the door is a win, isn't it? I mean, that's right. What an amazing run. And in a way, you shared it with your friend, you know? That's the beautiful thing about it too, is that, you know, she'd inspired you. And yeah, amazing, amazing.
Absolutely.
Well done, Sarah.
Right, on to our main conversation. Robbie Britton, he's a hoot, you know? He's intensely... He's probably, I'm hopefully he's got like webbed feet or a vestigial tail or something, because he's nice, he's good, he's smart, you know, as I said at the top.
He's got amazing hair.
He's got amazing hair. He can cycle really well. He's got a 229 marathon. He's represented Great Britain at the World 24-Hour Champs, 261 kilometer PB. He got the FKT on the Jordan Trail. And now he's written a book, 1001 Runner's Tips, The Essential Runner's Guide, and he joins us for this incredible conversation. So please enjoy.
Church Radio.
All the way from northern Italy, we have returning guest, coach, ultramarathon runner, and now author, Robbie Britton. Robbie, kia ora. Welcome back to Church Radio, and how are you going?
Thanks for having me back, guys. Returning guest. Must have done something right the first time.
No.
Yeah, no, I'm really good. Really good, thanks. Bit of a cold. I sound a little bit probably sexier than usual.
I'm in the same boat. When I get upper respiratory, my voice kind of drops about an octave. I quite like it. We've just been comparing our home haircuts. Eugene and I being in lockdown, and you going a bit aero for racing season. I mean, how has racing been in Europe?
With the haircut, it's definitely been easier, because like my hair does grow like a proper woolly hat. So you can't go race fast with a woolly hat on. So why would you do it with a? So I just cut off loads of it myself. I've actually raced for the first time in 2 years. Running an ultra distance. I've cycled some ultra distances, as you do. I did a 6-hour race last weekend, and this is probably. It's a good example of why going to a mass event and suppressing your immune system by running for 6 hours and then having people come up and shake your hands can often lead to picking up illnesses.
Oh.
I've had a COVID test. I haven't got COVID. We've done two. But yeah. It is just like a bog standard, old-fashioned cold. Not as fashionable these days, but...
a normal coronavirus.
It's kept me indoors. Yeah, well, I guess it's the same virus.
Yeah, yeah. So, so there we go. And what sort of? I mean, are they? What are the restrictions and so on a race in Europe at the stage, or are they pretty much none?
Because the vaccination level is a bit higher, so they're kind of like, well, if you've got the green pass, we're all good. And masks still necessary, but you're finding a lot more people kind of like, well, I've got two vaccinations. Like, yeah, it doesn't mean you can high five me on every lap. There's one guy who kept trying to high five me on every lap, and I was like, I'm not touching you, mate. But like, I wouldn't touch. I mean, I'm going to do 40 laps. I don't want to touch someone's hand every lap and then have to wash my hands, because you're going around the other side of that lap and like fiddling with your balls because the shorts aren't right and you're covered in Vaseline or something, and then you're putting your hand in the communal nuts. There were precautions. We all had our own table set out beforehand. The numbers were on the table, and your packet race pack was there, so it wasn't any. We were all checked for our green pass on the way in, and then you were supposed to be wearing a mask at that point. And then once you were checked, you could then take your mask off, go to your table. We had our own checkpoint food, so they provided a package to each person. They let you know beforehand what was going to be there. So ideally, you're then not kind of interacting with people. It was free runners to a table, so it was a bit squeezed, but again, you can, it's open air, you don't have to like touch people. And then, yeah, towards the end, I think people get tired and they're kind of, they just forget about it. You've relaxed, yeah, didn't you? And you're like, okay. Yeah. So then you see people, like, after the race, everyone was trying to like shake my hand because I'd won the race. And I was trying to fist bump everyone. And you get that awkward thing where you're fist bumping an open palm. You're like, yeah, cool, okay. And then they like, some of them, they insist I shake their hand. And they're like, no, I really want to shake your hand. It's like, great. This is what's happened because of that. Thank you. And I'm like washing my hand. And some people are looking, oh, you think I'm dirty? Yes.
You probably are.
Right now. I've been running for 6 hours. Like, we're all dirty right now. We've all been like coughing and spluttering. So then, yeah. So the presentation was outdoors. Everything was outdoors. They're doing everything you can. But I'm double vaccinated. Everyone there was double vaccinated or had a test in the previous 72 hours. And I've caught a cold. So I guess it's just it's probably a good reminder that it's not as simple as just giving everyone a vaccine and you can go back to like going out, getting hammered and hugging everyone, because don't hug everyone, people, and wash your hands.
Well, that's a lesson that that's a lesson that we're learning, the hard way at the moment in New Zealand. And I mean, you know, for me, I'm applying so much hand sanitizer at work that, you know, I'm in danger of exploding when I come home and make a cup of tea, put the gas on, I just go up like a human candle, you know, just I'm more hand sanitizer than man. But look,
the other thing we've learned though is that someone with their hand in the communal nuts has been touching other things.
Yeah.
Don't go for the communal nuts.
Eugene, you only just learnt that. I have not touched some communal nuts in about 10, 15 years. Like, people think it's, I use a crew to avoid the checkpoints for efficiency and speed. It's just because if I'm not there first, I don't want to put my hand in those carry bones.
Don't want to touch it. That's right. No.
You want to be more, like, if you're going to, look, it's cool, right? Get after it. And if you want to, you know, Frankie says relax, whatever, but it takes away. You're going to be there's going to be transmission there of particles,
of course, between fecal matter.
What
was the race?
It was just a 6 hour. It was ultra Andorra, but not Andorra the country. Andorra the small fancy little town on the Ligurian coast, and it was 2K loops over Marina. It was like a proper, I don't disrespect the race. It was a low competition. Just something, because I've been building back up my mileage from an injury over, like, it's been a couple of years. I wanted something in the kind of on the horizon to aim for, because it's all well and good to start in training with nothing to aim for, and there has to be some kind of like desire to do it. Because if I put a marathon in, I've got to run a PB. I'm not training for a marathon without trying for a PB and come back from an injury. Not always the best thing. 10K half marathon, not quite big enough to really motivate me to want to train for it. 6 hour, not long enough that it's going to absolutely destroy me, but it's a distance I hadn't done before. I knew I could kind of set off about going too fast, and I could work on things that might help me in the future, like my nutrition, my pacing, all these kind of bits and bobs. So yeah, it was just a little 6K, 6 hour, and just went and ran around with a bunch of other people on a marina.
And how far did you run?
75.9 kilometers. I was feeling. It's just like, it's just always good for my athletes. They love how much I talk about making sure you keep fueling and keep it like pace well. I like to think I wasn't pacing too hard. If you look at my heart rate monitor, I was going too quickly in the first half. In terms of pace, it wasn't. So potentially I didn't take the humidity into account as much as I should have, because I was looking. My legs felt good. And I was like, I was running at 6:30 per mile, thinking like, this is okay. And up until about 50K, I was honestly still thinking like of a negative split. I was thinking I'll start picking this up for the last couple of hours. And I started getting a lot of pain in my like lower stomach, and it's like felt like it was swelling up. Couple of theories on that, but then I started retching, and I tore an intercostal muscle. Not tore it, I strained it. Tore is a strong word. I tweaked it. And then I couldn't, I've never done that before. And I was really shallow breathing. So obviously your first instinct is that you're dying. So I was like, oh no, I'm dying. I feel so sorry for myself. And everyone thought, basically, I just looked like I went too fast at the start. And everyone was like, oh, that young guy, he's such an idiot. And I was like, I've been doing this for like so many years. I'm not young in terms of, I should know what I'm doing. I don't think I was pacing too hard. And then just like kind of really feeling sorry for myself for a few laps and went to the medical tent and then was like, okay, you're not dying. Oh, thank God. I'll try and walk a few laps. And then I was far enough ahead that that was allowed. That kind of mid-race drama was okay. And I think I was about 6K ahead of second place. So I got a giant trophy. It's huge. It's the biggest trophy I've ever won.
Really?
And €150. Yeah.
Oh, nice one. And you're away next week racing your bike.
Yes. There's a bike called a race called the Two Volcano Sprint, which is it's the first bike race I finished. It's not the first one I started. I started one before that and didn't finish it. It's the first one I finished 2 years ago and I finished it again last year and they said, well, there's four of you who've done both editions. Come back this year. We're starting in Sicily this time at Etna and then we're cycling up to Napoli on a different route and I couldn't resist. So I entered again. Like, you don't want to miss out as well. So like in the kind of brilliant example settings, schedule setting, I had a 6 hour race and then a good 10 week period of having a cold and doing nothing. And then a race of 1100 kilometers with 26,000 meters of climbing.
That's something you'd advise the people you coach to do, I'm sure.
It makes my job harder doing things. Like I've already had a kind of message like, oh yeah, so you know when you said I shouldn't do races too close together? Well, it's different because it's me.
That's right.
But it, also the bike, you can. I basically it's picking you. I know I'll finish it without too. I don't have to do too much bike training. I was fit from the running and I was kind of willing to compromise my performance in the bike race and lower the priority of that because the focus went on to the running race. And ideally I was going to do some cycling in the small block between and have a very short taper. You can taper a lot shorter on the biking because with the run taper, you're making sure you really reduce that muscle fatigue as well and just the overall fatigue. Whereas the bike, it's less about the muscular fatigue. So it's a lot easier to keep it quite steady. I mean, you can tell I'm living in Italy. I'm gesticulating on a podcast, trying to use examples with my hands. And then you can drop down quite late with a taper, I find. It works differently for different people and recover quite quickly and be ready for a bike race. So that was the initial plan. I'm running out of window to do any considerable cycling before the race starts next Friday because, I can't really. I've been staying indoors because it's not really. I'm supposed to ride with a couple of friends. I've cancelled that because I don't want to make them ill. I've gone on Zwift, and it's very warm. So yeah, hopefully I'm just focusing on recovery.
Yeah. What bike are you riding in that race?
Oh, I'm riding a Flanders Forte frame set, which is actually an Australian company now. It was a Belgian company. And it's basically a mix between a cyclocross bike and a gravel bike. So I built it up myself. My friend built the wheel. He's got a company called Zola. And it's all kind of, it's set for long distance, but it's set for racing long distance. So it's got quite an aggressive, geometry, but it can fit 45 mil tires on.
Nice.
So it's comfortable. I've tried to save weight in some places. We've still got like the Shimano GRX group set. So it's got like a 48, 31 on the front, which gives you some, like, I haven't got big legs. I don't need a 54 on the front. Was it 53-11 life? That's what the cyclists say. That, like, I can't turn the wheels when it's in a massive gear. I've got tiny little legs. So I need, it's built for going up hills for a long time. And but for racing up them, it weighs about just over eight kilos. And I load up all the Apadura race bags on there and fill them with food and some clothes and off I go. And try not to stop and try not to sleep because that's when I catch the real cyclists.
And in between your six-hour adventures, your massive cycling adventures, you've written a book.
Yeah. 1001 running tips. Basically, think I would have enough, but I've probably got too many. Got more.
You got more than 1001.
What possessed you?
Yeah, we missed bits. I want to add bits in, but now I have to wait for another edition or something, maybe. But there's like a. I think I sent over about 1,070 because obviously there's some rubbish tips in there. And if you give them 1,070, the editor can kind of go, oh, that's rubbish. Get rid of that tip. Whoosh. You're just repeating yourself, mate. Get rid of that. You can't say that. That's just downright rude. 1,001.
So what possessed you to write a book? What was the process?
What's the process? That's good to get a bit of cerebral on this one. So it was this time last year, because I was on the way to the same bike race last year, and it's a friend of mine is a commissioning editor for this company, and she said, oh, we want to get you to write this book. We think you'd be a good person to write. There's 1001 climbing tips by a guy called Andy Kirkpatrick, who's a like, proper nails, big wall climber. His style is basically like you see a lot of like the super kind of lean kind of climbing machines that look great on Instagram. Andy Kirkpatrick is good at just suffering and like sitting on a big wall and going up in horrible conditions. Hopefully that's not an insult to him, but that's what I admire him for. And his writing, he's written a couple of really good books. Cold Wars is the most recent one. And he wrote 1001 climbing tips. They thought we'd do 1001 running tips. And it's kind of like it's a bit more lighthearted than your general kind of reference book. It's no law of running. But I've tried to include information in there that anyone picking it up can find like a good advice and use it in a way that they might use a textbook, but they also might just put it in their toilet and read it every time they go for a dump and pick up a few tips. But yeah, so I wrote it November, December. As with anything, I just got like as deep into the process as possible and just had a big whiteboard with my topics that I kept thinking of on one side, and then like a large, I don't know if you have Blue Peter, like when it had like the big kind of, we're raising money for orangutans and we have to raise this much. I did that. I built my own little kind of orangutan money raising thing, and as I filled in tips, I kind of coloured in the big chart. And yeah, November, December last year, I did the main bulk of it there, and then I got to put it aside for January. And just no other reason than kind of giving myself time to mature as an adult and come back to it and go, okay, let's tweak these. And then, yeah, over this year, it's been back and forth with the editors and with the pictures, and now we're doing the podcast and the social media stuff before it launches on 15th. It's launched now for pre-order, and then it's 15th of November it is published. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, it is pretty cool. I mean, 1001, I mean, it is actually a lot. I'll be the first to admit, I got the email saying, hey, from your publisher saying, do you want to talk to Robbie? And I looked at it and I perceived it as 101 running tips. I thought, oh, that's pretty cool. That's cool. And then I went back and had a closer look and I was like, oh, it's 1001. Wow, that's another.
That's a lot of tips.
That's a lot of tips.
I think I'd struggle with 101. I mean, like, imagine even not like a podcast, we could probably go through 101 tips, right? Just go through it. 1001, you can get into the nitty gritty of it. You're not cutting out anything you really don't want to cut out. I don't know. I was going through it, so I was trying to do some social media stuff to share some tips. And a lot of them don't work on their own. They're not the short, snappy, like, I don't know, wear a hat and your head won't get cold. Brilliant. But like, it's they kind of flow, the sections, and they flow together, and it feels almost like I've written a book, like an actual, it's just broken up, it's just short paragraphs rather than tips. No, I'm just kidding. They are tips, they are separate. But I don't know, I think I was chatting to Mael Backhausen, he might have introduced me to your podcast. And he was like, yeah, man, I knew you had that many tips in you. I'm surprised you could just, he said, I've spent enough years running with you. You're just kind of just constantly talking. So I'm glad that I could put them on paper. And then we're always learning more tips though, aren't we? Like since I've written that in December, there's other stuff that I'm like, oh, and we change what we know about the tips we've already given out. Like I've definitely given advice in the past that's changed. You're like looking at it thinking like, oh, okay, do it. I don't really think that anymore. I mean, this the book now is currently very much aligned with my current thinking. But I know that in like 2 or 3 years' time, I'm going to be, yeah, I don't really agree with that anymore. I'm going to have to go around and just like scribble in people's books. And sorry, I'm editing this one.
If people come up to you for get them signed, you'll have to cross some out.
Yeah,
adjust them. Ignore that one. Ignore that one. Yeah,
there's a study in 2023 that disagreed with this. Come on, it's updated.
Phil Noakes did that, didn't he? His book Thirst. He wrote his book on hydration, and he included a nutrition part. And then he's totally rethought his nutritional strategy. You know, he was sick, and he radically adapted the way he ate. And he actually says, if you buy the book, tear that bit out of it. Like, actually, literally rip the chapter out and throw it in the bin. Like,
I think, yeah. Did he remove his name from some papers and research as well?
He got did. That?
Because it, which is a yep. bit, because you look at someone like Louise Burke, who was obviously, she's done a lot of stuff on low carb, high fat diets. And she'd previously been really pro it, and then kind of, she'd kind of gone up and down. I think she wrote one like, is this the nail in the coffin for low carb, high fat? And she's been on that academic journey research journey, because we don't know the answer. It's the reason we research and do experiments in the first place. We, as if I'm doing any, most of my experimenting is with pacing at 6 hour runs and doing it badly. But yeah, like, you look at her journey, and I feel it adds credibility to where they eventually end up, because
you follow the science. Journey.
Yeah, and you've actually, you've disproved yourself. You thought, okay, I've got this fear. I'm going to double check it. Oh, look, actually, it could be quite wrong. So I find it interesting that someone would remove their previous research. That obviously means the science, you saying like, well, that science was incorrect. You can say we were wrong, or we were testing the wrong thing and we're developing it, and actually we've changed our thinking. But to kind of go back and go, nah, we lied about that.
Yeah.
I think it came, I'm only postulating, I think it, because it so personally affected him, you know, like he, and oh God, I'm only going off, you know, Chris McDougall's book, Natural Born Heroes. You know, there's a big bit in it about how he was sick, he was pre-diabetic and all this stuff. And so maybe that's part to do with it. But I agree with you. It's interesting, isn't it? If you could actually have the academic integrity to question yourself and postulate that, you know, you're...
Well, I quite like the idea of it, Matt, and that maybe there's some podcast, you know, episodes that we're not proud of that we could just go back and like take our names off them. You know, that's, I don't right. know.
Just change, like, go in post and change the kind of your two voices. And
yeah,
like, it must be some kind of program you do that. And you're like, oh, that doesn't sound like
yeah.
That.
Or just have no voice. Edit the questions out and just have somebody talking.
It sounds like something that Donald Trump would do, though. So I'll be careful. You're going down. You're on sketchy ground here, guys.
Oh, you mean deep fake? No, I actually have and I won't mention the person's name because their followers are multitudinous and very, very fervent, but I'd like to see their podcast. I think it would be much more interesting with them edited out. Like, incredible guests, really interesting. And
guess it now.
If they could just edit that person out, it'd be even cooler. Like, but we won't mention that person's name for fear.
We'll do that one afterwards, and guests could guess which one they mean.
Yeah, that's right. We're running a competition.
I'm writing this down.
Yeah.
I've got a guess on that. I wonder if we're the same person in mind. But yeah, carry on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was wondering for a little while if he's talking about me, and then he said multitudinous followers. So I was like, oh, no, that's me right. out. Yeah.
We caught a plane with one, Eugene. Remember that time?
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, hey, he was a devotee.
He was an acolyte indeed, the highest order. Hey, look, Robbie, I mean, give us an example of a tip that you'd give to a runner, you know, maybe a beginner or an enthusiastic amateur that is more sort of contemporaneous that you've just sort of come up, or not come up with, but like where is, say, 2, 3, 4, 5 years ago, you would have given different advice?
Well, we should have given different advice.
Different tip.
I suppose from a coaching point of view, and even from the way this book is written, the tips 4 or 5 years ago would have been very much, you do this, you do that. This is how we do things. You do these interval trainings, you do this. And now I realize it's much more complex and more individual. So there's a lot of times in the book where it's getting you to ask yourself questions. The tip is, instead of do this training for this race, it's like, ask yourself what's worked for you in the past. And it, so it's maybe changing the, like, it comes less from you should do this and kind of a transactional kind of relationship with the author and the reader to transformational, trying to get the reader to question their own and make their own decisions through a book that basically, thousand and one running tips. Doesn't sound like it's trying to do that. It's just loads of little bits of advice. But yeah, I suppose that's changed. It's probably less the information because, man, people have been running fast for God knows how long. Like we don't know that much new. We've got some really good stuff around nutrition and developments, and some of the training principles they've been refined. But I mean, Amel Zetovec was doing stuff that it was groundbreaking then. It's not so groundbreaking now. I'm not saying we go and put boots on and run around in the bath, but the intervals he was doing and all these kind of different things, there's bits of that we take from, that's all kind of, everything we have, nothing's that new, but it's how we kind of put it across and how we kind of say, actually, and this has definitely changed. I think there are coaches that have done this for decades, but I think we're seeing a bit of a shift in where it's less about telling someone what to do and more about kind of getting them to ask themselves the right questions. So the tips that I would have written years ago would have been much more instructional. And these are, right. I'm going to have to reread it. I think these are more like, there are some that like basically don't set off like a lunatic and make sure you pack some toilet roll because you might shit yourself in your first ultra. Like that's all good advice that I would give to someone. Like, there are other bits that are like about helping someone find out what works for them, and maybe that's the difference from me 4 or 5 years ago.
So it's a bit of a choose your own adventure book.
So say that again.
Bit of a choose your own adventure. You remember those books?
There is a,
you know, those choose the your own we adventure. You get an option
when you follow different lines and stuff like that. Maybe I could have done that.
Yeah, 1001. So,
there are bits like. We do have links where you take it to other. If you like this, go to this section. Like read tips here and here. Oh, I actually like those books.
That was cool.
Tip 564: hands out of the communal nuts.
No, I think that's number one.
Yeah, just stay away from it.
It's in there. I think it is in there. There is one about communal nuts. It's definitely getting mentioned.
Was it you, Eugene, you were telling me, or was it Sean? Or was it a friend of ours, Sean Cooper, very accomplished 24-hour runner? He told a story of he was running with a group of people who had a rummage around in the community.
No, that was somebody I was running with at Tarawera who, everyone else came up to an aid station into the, I think they wouldn't have been nuts, they would have been, you know, lollies or something, sweets.
Jubes.
You know, jubes, yeah. And then within, I think it was half an hour of that aid station, they'd all gone down with vomiting and like, because somebody had been handling their junk.
That's quite a quick incubation period.
It is quite a quick incubation.
Yeah.
I would still say like you look at its stats, how many are you talking about? Four out of a group of five. Okay. I think they probably pace that. I mean, I would look at pacing and hydration as well in that one. I guess the last week or so, this is a really interesting thing that we all do as athletes, is we look back for reasons that are beyond our control for our weaknesses in our performance. We're like, okay, is there a way that I can take the blame for myself? It's not my pacing, it's not my hydration, my fueling, my mental toughness, my training. So I have this cold right now. And so my mind instantly goes like, well, maybe my heart rate would start high at the start because the cold was already here before the race. Chances are, no, I was just pacing badly in humid conditions. But we do that. We find different reasons. It sounds like it's a potential because a half hour period for putting your hands aside and being sick.
Look, I mean, I think if it's a tale of warning, you know, to warn people off doing it, I don't mind if the truth has been stretched.
Did Jonah really go in the whale? I mean, come on.
Come on. I'm only asking questions.
Hey, Robbie, how have you noticed over the, I mean, last time we spoke to you, you guys were on the horns of the first wave, the good old days of regular COVID. Remember those salad days. Have you noticed that your athletes, what they want out of coaching has changed over the last year with everything that's been going on around the world?
That's a good question. I suppose, we've got a group of coaches I work with at Centurion Running, but also we have a little network of different coaches we chat to. And you find out, like, I suppose we've all tried to be more proactive with our coaching, because I think, yeah, I guess what's missing from a lot of people's running right now is the social aspect of it. So as a coach, can you provide some element of that? And it comes back to like the motivation, like self-motivational theory. It requires some relatedness to the sport and what you're involved with. And you can get that from a coach-athlete relationship, but that's a one-to-one one. So one of the things that I've changed and I found really helpful is introduced, it's simply like a WhatsApp group of all of my athletes in there. And that community, we've kind of created our own little community. You're in a group, there's a special group, there's some interesting people in there, and there's a lot of knowledge in that group. So like on a very practical level, if you can ask one of my athletes, if they was asking about different coats, like down jackets, and people have their own experience. Someone's doing a race. Half the people in the like foot three of people in the race have like, if you guys had a group, you say, oh, what's it like at mile 60 of Tarawera? And you'd be like, oh, brilliant. Well, oh, yeah, actually, it's really good. Well, I say mile 60, kilometer 60, because mile 60, you're at the end, unless you're in the 100. So, yeah, one of the things is I found is that some of us have needed that social connection more through coaching and through the community we've got there, because we're not getting it from the running club. We're not getting it from race weekend with our friends. We're not getting it. And sometimes social media is not the healthiest place to get that connectiveness, because it comes with a lot of negative connotations. And that's not to say the WhatsApp group I've got doesn't also come with negative connotations. It's been interesting because like, sometimes it's actually like if someone else is racing and you're injured, or actually it's because there's a range of level of athlete in there as well, and it can be quite intimidating. Everyone's faster than me and things like that. That can have a negative aspect as well. So it's, yeah, I think that the connectiveness, actually having kind of meaningful connections, is one of the things that some of us, personally, I find it as well, like it's something that's been missing, because we have our family and life around us, but it's good, it's healthy to have a bigger circle of relationships and that. And maybe, yeah, through coaching, I've tried to say, to make sure that it's not changing the world, right? But it's there as an option if people want to communicate and have people to chat to and feel like they're in the same boat as well. We think our problems are our own and they're the worst in the world at times, and it can feel like that, especially if things aren't going great. And to realise that actually we're all in the same boat a little bit, and yeah, we're all missing going out to running or running with friends. And so we've seen that kind of lesson, because people are getting out to run with their friends again, and that the races are starting again. And we think about it as, oh yeah, I just miss racing, but actually it's that social element of it that's probably most important for our motivation.
Absolutely. And that, yeah, I mean, even just thinking about stuff lately, sort of, we've gone back into a new, you know, new sort of lockdown phase after having lots of freedom. And sometimes there's stuff going on, you know, internally or whatever, and you can't quite put your finger on it because you're not, whereas normally you'd have those conversations with your mates and it's like, oh, they're going through the same thing too. Oh, okay, right, I get it. Yeah, this is all just part of, I'm a bit messed up because we're back in lockdown and I'm annoyed or whatever. That's a bit oversimplified, but it's those social connections, those talking to people that you can work through stuff. It helps you work through things, whereas if you're just battling away on your own, you know,
and
not,
if you're only
not talking to your running
your
mates, you don't
on Instagram.
Know. Pardon?
If you're only seeing your friends on Instagram, yeah. And they're only showing their Instagram like selves, aren't they?
Bang.
No one. Yeah. Not often you see like, oh yeah, how was your day? Oh, it was rubbish, and I've just been a bit sad today. Sometimes you get that on Instagram, but generally that's what it's all it is. You don't get the ups and downs. Someone's either showing all the good stuff or all the bad stuff, and that's what they show on social media. That's what they've chosen to show.
Yeah.
And you can't just like sit there with a friend, like, yeah, or go for a run with a friend and just realise that maybe they're having a tough time and you've got to be there for them. And that's one of the things that I feel is, yeah, for me, is a massive part of running, because it's the people, it's the community. And it feels weird organising a Zoom meeting with people, because I've been doing it for years because I really like the platform and I use it through my coaching, because it's so much better than actually just on the phone. I love chatting on the phone, as I like talking, but it's just that when you go for a run with someone, you can tell, especially if you run with someone regularly, you can tell when they're not themselves. And it's harder to do that the more, like, the less physically there we are in terms of that communication.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? Like, again, I remember Eugene and I were talking about this platform before lockdown and sort of going, oh, wacky, you know, like that'll never catch on. A video, you know, you could talk to people in your homes. And now it's, I mean, you know, as a nurse, I have up to 4 Zoom meetings a day sometimes. Plus, you know, I never in my career would I thought that like this would actually in frontline healthcare, that it would be so, you know, so integral. It really has been one of those things that kind of changed, eh? Like the normal or the dial is kind of switched. Just, it's just ratcheted up that little bit much, hey?
This, and this, that's reminding me of one of the other things I've seen with athletes in their time, right? So when the lockdowns first happened, we removed the commute from a lot of people, removed the pointless meetings, right? Initially, they were working from home. They were getting shit done, right? It was like, and they had an extra hour in the morning where they were like, oh, what do I do? I'll go out for a run or a walk. Oh, in the evening, I'll finish early because, look, and as the lockdowns and the times continue, we've gone back to normal, especially people who live in London, those commute times have become work times. The endless meetings at work that were kind of wasting your time have become Zoom meetings. And people are sitting there on Zoom meetings that don't matter. Probably more so than before. Like, okay, right, well, yeah, I don't really know why I'm here, so I'll try and secretly do some work. Like, you can, if you're careful, you can't see that you're tight. Unless you type like this, like with your shoulders jumping around, you can get more work done whilst, or like on your phone. You can imagine people just kind of looking at the camera on their phone. But yeah, we found the habits that made working in an office probably, or working face-to-face, less productive, just gradually crept back in because people, they exhaust it and they don't have a switch. So they switch off. They don't leave an office. And I've seen people just absolutely working themselves to the bone because they're at home now. And it's like, I mean, I've done it for years working from home, but I'm not great at switching off, but I like to think I get the balance just about right.
Yeah. I know too, my wife and I are both working at home. And I mean, she's worked at home for, I don't know, 15 years. And I think the fact that we're both home means that we've ended up working later and later and later. And it's because it's not like, oh, I'm coming home now, I'm on my way home kind of thing. You know, what, it's not, one of us is not sort of putting us a full stop on the day. Both of us just have an open-ended sort of day. And so you do end up just dragging on and on and on. It's, yeah.
And usually there might be stuff in the evening you would do that before that. You might go to running club, or you might be doing something else slightly more social. And now that's not there either. So you're like, well, what should I do? I could watch Netflix, or I could keep working.
Yeah.
And those are the two options.
Yeah.
Go for a run.
Yeah. Every time.
Yeah. I go option. Well, I mean, this is the thing. I think about I was talking to a runner this morning. We sort of socially distanced in the forest for the last kilometre of his run, and running out of the forest, and I sort of reflected, I was like, yeah, I get to go to work every day. It's pretty good. Like, it's very hard, but I get to leave the house, you know, like I do things, you know, I still, and my commute's shorter because no one's on the road, you know, like you just, like what would take me half an hour takes me now less than 15 minutes, you know, like there's that real sense of like, yeah, I feel a great, it's this funny sort of privilege that, yeah, I get to kind of leave the house and get out.
It makes us appreciate things as well, doesn't it? Stuff that we wouldn't usually appreciate. I remember that first, we had a 2-month lockdown here where I couldn't leave. We could leave the house to go to the supermarket, which my wife and I did together as like a center. It was like, wow, let's go out once every 10 days to go to the supermarket. I like supermarkets anyway. It's just lots of things I can eat and buy and just like don't need. And then we could walk the dogs, and Nats could walk the dog for 200 metres up and down the road. And even then the neighbours were like, what are you doing? Like, we're in the middle of nowhere. We're at the end of a valley where we can go 200 metres. We kind of drew a circle, and that got us onto a trail and back again. But even then the neighbours were a bit like, what are you doing? And you're like, okay. And I stayed indoors. Apart from the supermarket, I didn't go out. I wanted Nats to be able to use the time out with the dogs. And I spent 2 months, I had a dumb turbo, which is so like wasn't changing. It was just me staring at a wall for 2 months, like reading books sometimes, or chatting to my nan on a few calls. And that's one of the good things. It's made me speak to my gran a fair bit more. And then I come out for that first ride, and I was thinking like, it'd be all right, not that bothered. And it was like I just discovered sport for the first time. It was like, wow, this is brilliant. And it's like a wide grin on my face. And same with like going out for a run again after that. Well, going out for a run post-injury and not having, kind of building up to levels that I couldn't do before. Just that big, I mean, it's a rush of endorphins, but it's that grin, that kind of satisfaction, that also, like, you're just content that you can do something that actually probably feels, I feel like a lot of this for the last couple of years has made me really appreciate the things that do go well, and to focus on those and to be really happy that I go ride my bike in some hills. And that's very simple but very enjoyable task.
Oh, look, I mean, Eugene and I went for the first run together. How long has it been?
2 months.
Yeah, two months. We saw each other face to face, first time in 2 months, on Saturday morning. And we hadn't been, our local forest's been closed because, you know, they're logging and you can't recreate during lockdown. So they opened it up and it was amazing. It was like, yeah, we're discovering, we're like, oh, it's a hill. We can run up this hill because we've been running on the roads, you know. So it's like run up a hill and remember how hard running up a hill is. But it was incredible. It was. It was like being a trail that we've both run probably hundreds of times. It was magical. It really was.
Yeah, I've had two months of just, so we were confined to our neighborhood, and I happen to live at sea level, and there's nothing more, you know, I think the biggest, the biggest hill is basically at Jadabar, you know, it's flat. So I've had no hills. So then getting back into the forest yesterday was great, but it was sort of like, ooh, I'm having to work differently here. My body was sort of saying, what's this? Gravity? Sorry.
I mean, you guys, I feel I should probably bow out of the conversation at this point, because, I mean, Eugene, you've been running around in circles. You're training specifically.
Yeah, I'm training for my first 24-hour race.
Ah, nice.
Yeah.
This is where I got some tips, mate.
Yeah. So flip to how many of the 1,001 are for 24-hour races, and do any of them start with don't do it? Because, you know, I'm wondering.
No. Actually, I've only given out one tip that was my mate the other day. He was like, is there any tips about running a marathon in ski boots? And I was like, yeah, don't do it, mate.
Don't do it.
I told you already. And he still did it. He set a record by about 12 seconds, and I'm still like,
wow.
Well done. What?
Paul Bennett, well done. Great. He was raising some money for charity, but my advice for running a marathon in ski boots, don't do it, because Paul's got the record. Let him have it.
Are we talking about the fully rigid ones with the, like, the... And again, I'm gesticulating on an audio-only podcast, but the 45-degree angle...
Proper old-school ski boots. He wasn't allowed to use ski... He was going through it with him, and, like, there were stipulations for this record, and he had to wear a ski outfit, and he was dressed up as Eddie the Eagle, and he wore his rigid boots, and they were just... Like I wanted to see. I was like, right, it's well done, mate, but show me the sores. I want to see what happened to your feet. And he had like these kind of welts on his feet where they kind of, and his shin and his top of his foot.
Oh.
Yeah, they're grim. So that's don't do that. That's my advice. I said 24-hour running, do go out and try it. It's brilliant.
Yeah.
It's just, you learn a lot about yourself. You learn a lot about your running, and you can take a lot of that, especially psychologically. If you can convince, and this is all you've got to do, right? You've got to run 24 hours. You've got to move for 24 hours. Probably a better way of thinking. Can I move for 24 hours? Okay, that's my goal. Okay, rather than a number. And then you step back and you go, what am I going to do to move for 24 hours? What's going to stop me moving? Okay, running out of energy, blisters and being uncomfortable or chafing, feeling really sleepy. And you look at the factors that might make you stop running for 24 hours, stop moving. I've got to stop using running, because you can move for 24 hours. And if you go into a 24-hour race with a goal of moving for those full 24 hours, you will find yourself get a good total. And you'll find yourself getting closer to your potential than if you said, right, I want to run 240K. How do I do that? And then you start looking like that, and you think, then you start picking arbitrary numbers to start at, and you start getting, you pick goals along the way. And what if you get to the race, like I did last weekend, and it's really humid? Then you start making decisions that are linked to running a set distance rather than moving for 24 hours. And you find yourself coming unstuck in the second half of that race. And that's when a 24-hour race, all of us can run well when it feels good. We're good at running well when it's nice, because you haven't got to run fast for a 24-hour race. But you make a good distance by running well when you feel like utter garbage. That's the right. time when you see, like, because there are times, and yeah, if you get that magical one where you have a perfect 24-hour race, it's still really hard. It's still going to be a mental battle, because at times you're like, right, I feel like rubbish. I've been running for 14 hours, which feels like a long time. I've still got 10 hours to go, which also feels like a long time. It feels like I should be closer to the finish. And you know what? There's my crew. There's my, like, I could sit there and I'd still be like bringing the clock down at the same pace. I could just lay on the floor there for a while and cry, sob uncontrollably. And I'm getting to the finish line as quickly as sprinting. So what's the point of all of it? And that you'll find those questions going in your head. And actually, well, the point is I'm trying to move for 24 hours. I want to keep going and see what I'm capable of. But like I think I've spoke before in a 5K or running up a hill, your subconscious screams at you to stop. Don't do this. It hurts. It hurts. Why are you doing this to me? Right. And in a 24-hour race, you don't really have that screaming. You have a quiet whisper in your ear like, stop. You should stop. Give up. What's the point? This is absolutely ridiculous. And it just kind of whispers in your ear the whole time. And you got to be like, no. Like, voice, it's okay. I'm doing this because I think I'm going to do really well. I want to find out what I'm capable of. And the next lap is like, no, stop. This is pointless. And you're like, oh, no, it's a good idea, right? Look, I'm overtaking that guy over there. And then someone will whiz past in a relay. And you go, see, you're rubbish. And you're like, no, I'm not rubbish. Yeah. I've been running for 16 hours. I'm fueling while I'm moving. I'm here for me. And then it'd be like someone else will come past who might be like, I don't know,
in ski boots.
Yeah, in ski boots. Or they've had a 6 hour sleep and they've got up in the morning and they're buzzing around. I always tell those people off, I'm like, guys, you don't know the psychological impact you're having on the people who've been out for 24 hours and you've had a kip. You could do that at home. You could have gone for a run, slept and gone out again in the morning at home. You're showing off in the morning and you're making it harder for the people. Changes our perception of effort. If we see someone running faster, it reminds us how much slower we're going at that moment in time, and it will subconsciously change our perception of effort, which makes everything harder. So like Samuel McCorah's research around, and this is interesting, like with Tim Noakes' central governor, Samuel McCorah, some of their Twitter spats are impressive for academic, well-educated men. They just kind of end up swearing at each other. It's great. and the central governor theory around, like, yeah, you just... We can go further than we imagine, and we have to push beyond it, and we push ourselves into situations. I would say a rudimentary understanding to it, but for me, the central governor is, it's important to have a very good why. You've got to keep why you're still going, right? And you can go into the depths of hell and still go if you've got reason to keep going, because there is an extra. So ideally, it would be a lion chasing you, because that's when you tap into your deepest reserves. With the Samuel McCorah stuff around perception of effort, we've got a bit more control of that. We're not as much control, but we can kind of be aware of it, because external factors affect how hard our running is. And I use the example, I don't want to repeat myself from the last podcast, but I've used this before, where if you've got two guys running a marathon, they're at mile 20 and both of them are running 6 minute miles. They're genetic clones. They've done the same training. And one person's overtaking people and the other's being overtaken. It's going to feel harder for one of those individuals because, well, like, they're being overtaken. So their perception of how well they're going just drops. And the one who's overtaking people, his perception of how well he's going rises. And from a physiological point of view, nothing's different. Everything's identical. But it's actually, and you know as a runner that would be harder if you're being overtaken. And that's, you can keep that in mind for a 24-hour race. Because if there's relays, if there's people who've slept a bit, or people just going faster, you've got to even if you're not kind of conscious of it, it happens. Someone comes past your shoulder, your head will drop a little bit. I watched it with Camille Herron when she set one of her world records at Desert Solstice. And Bob Hearn, who's an American runner who paces fantastically, and he's going around. And I said to my mate, like, we dropped that at this point. It was a very expensive trip to run on a track for a small while. I said, look, Camille's going to drop her head. She's setting a world record. She's 20 miles ahead of everyone else. I said, watch her drop when Bob comes past her. And he's like, she's not, she's miles ahead of him. It doesn't matter. And he came past slowly and she was running well, and her head dropped and she slowed down for a bit. And maybe it was like 5-6 seconds. Then she picked up again. She kind of, once that frame of reference went, she was back into her own. She's very good a bit at that. And she's back into her own frame. And then, like, I don't know, like 8 minutes later, he's going to come past again. And it's going to have So then as well, you know that if you're a fast finisher in a competitive race, especially at 24, you can use that to yourself. Just make sure as you go past, you're smart. Doing great, mate. Well done. Knowing that your competition is getting like eaten inside at the soul level.
Yeah.
There was that example, and I can't it was recently, was it, Eugene, it was a track and field event? It was a collegiate track and field event. It was the Kiwi who passed the American. The American was like waving in the stands and like...
Oh, the old celebration early.
The early celebration. Yeah. And and the Kiwi put a big kick in and passed him and won. But the dude's head dropped and you could hear him audibly. He went, oh, like it was this it was from his soul. It just left. You could hear it leaving his body, you know, and going, does it just evaporate? It was beautiful. I mean, poor guy, but also.
No, you can't feel sorry for the person celebrated early.
It's got to be like.
It's got to be like no communal nuts. Don't celebrate early. That's got to be number two. The 1001 tips.
That's how most of my races go wrong. First 800 meters, I'm like, yeah, and then the communal nuts, and it's all over. Yeah, I should really get your book.
So, you must have had a lot of fun diving into sort of latest research and seeing some of the new science. Was there any stuff that blew your mind as someone who knows, you know, I mean, you're such a student of our sport and of endurance generally, but was there anything that you came across in the research for the book or even since then that you've gone, I did not know that?
I guess a lot of it, so the tips were coming from me, so I would have backed stuff up, but like, a lot of it was from what I already knew rather than going into
the other way around.
Different areas. I'm not saying that makes me sound like I know everything. I don't, right? So I have to double check things. But I was writing it from my own experience. So there might be, I like to keep as up to date as I can with what's going on. And I like to, I actually find one of the most useful things for that is Twitter. It's really good to, if you follow the right people and don't follow like conspiracy theorists, then you can get some decent information, see some papers shared and like pre-publication papers and that, or just like the newer stuff.
Who are the good people to follow?
Who are the good people to follow? I like Stephen Seiler, Louise Burke, Trent Sterlingworth. There's a few good people that give out. So they just share other people. But you just find yourself, if you find some good academics that share like good endurance research, and then you can then, when they share something, you're like, oh, who do they share? Who do they tweet? Oh, that's good. Follow. Follow. And then, again, like, if you are reading a paper, so I like Google Scholar is a really good, if you want to find something, like some new research, you go into Google Scholar, and you can search the dates that the papers are coming from, and you put in your keywords, and you find, but you can then cross-reference that to not only the other papers in the references, but also onto social media, and you might find them sharing some more recent research they've done. So I think social media can be really useful for that side of things. But it also, the last couple of years, I've been doing the IOC Sports Nutrition Diploma. So that's been handy to kind of, because you're forced to stay on top of things because you're and that's run by Louise Burke, who's and Ron Morn, and they're kind of to the top in sports nutrition. They're top of the game. You're making sure that you stay on top of it as a coach, but even as an athlete and any of you do, it's good to keep trying to improve. None of us are anywhere near knowing everything about our sport.
Sports nutrition. Sports nutrition is a topic, especially a topic, an area where it seems that, you know, things that are changing. We're just learning so much, aren't we? There's so much we don't know about the human body and how it performs under stress.
And we're learning so much. Fundamental stuff that we can pick from other sports, like, because the research into ultra distance running isn't ideal. It's not big numbers, and it's kind of, I think some of the studies out there that they look at, there's too many factors involved in the race, right? So take your friend with your example with it before, with the nuts and the being sick, and 80% of people who ate nuts at checkpoint 4 were sick, right? And that seems kind of clear cut, and you see a fair few studies like that where it's kind of like we've looked at it and we've seen most people done this, but you'd have to also look at pacing strategies, at hydration strategies, at pre-race sodium levels, at post-race, like all these other factors that come in, how many hours of training are done, to actually find out if that was the reason, or like if that was actually the cause of what happened. And I think because the sport's so complex, it is hard to do some really control. Even looking at, so like, some really good stuff of race walkers, the supernova studies, and it's about keeping back to Louise Burke and her team, but they had races in race walkers of Olympic standard in the training camp for 3 weeks, and they were doing the two protocols, the low carb, high fat, and a normal high carb diet, and trying to control as much as possible. They still have to take into account the training camp effect. The fact that they brought all these people together, they're going to improve because they're all together. And what can we measure? Yeah. But even, and there's a guy, Vitor, is a really good study that is some Spanish sports nutritionist. And they got them testing with 120 grams of carbs an hour. They had 120, 90 and 60 grams of carbs an hour for a 6-hour mountain run. And but they didn't measure performance. They didn't measure pacing or anything. They measured muscle damage. And he looked at muscle damage markers afterwards, because the idea, like, again, it doesn't, we're not saying that eating that much improves your performance, because we can't prove that, because there's so many factors involved. But they can prove that there was less muscle damage in the group having 120 grams as opposed to 60 grams, and there was no difference in the GI issues, because then you can hypothesize on that. That's all they can say with certainty. That's muscle damage.
Right.
We can't say it's better for you. But then you can infer that, okay, well, it's because the body's like doing less eating its own muscles. Brilliant. It's a positive effect. And you can, like, having less muscle damage in the second half of that race is going to be, but then it could be tied to that this at random, because it's a small sample group. The people in that first group are actually also very good at downhill technique. So they've got less muscle damage. It's hard.
Mm. What did they use? Was it like CK levels to measure the muscle damage? Was it creatine kinase levels, or was it C-reactive protein?
I'll find the paper, because I think it was the first one you said, CK levels. I've got it saved on here. But it's, yeah, I will double check for you.
I love that stuff. I think it's incredible. It's so incredible how it's molecular. It's just fantastic.
It's not like you can set up lab experiments easily for endurance conditions, is it? It's just not something you can replicate.
And you can set up lab conditions for some good. You can do some good stuff on treadmills in labs, but how does that relate to the real world? And this was done in the real world, and it's interesting. So it's the lead author, Aitor Virabe, effects of 120 grams of carbohydrate intake during the mountain marathon on exercise-induced muscle damage in elite runners, and they tested. Results revealed that the experimental group evidenced significantly lower CK, so creatine kinase, after the race and 24 hours after the race as well. Conclusion, higher carb intake during a mountain exercise marathon would limit the exercise-induced muscle damage observed by CK, LDH and GOT, which is lactase dehydrogenase, and glutamic, I don't even know what that means, oxalocytic transaminase. See, this is why I don't remember all these things. I don't know. I know what it means, the study. The big words, they pretty scary. So I'll stick with I know what that means, roughly.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, that's what they measured. They looked at the muscle damage biomarkers.
Yeah, but is that because they trained in a certain way? Is that because, like you're saying, it's just small sample groups?
You got caught, and this is the thing. I mean, you get caught on a barbed wire fence, your CK level is going to go up. You get an injection, your CK level is going to go up. You know, like,
right?
You get in a fight in the pub after the race, CK level is going to go up. It's
you get annoyed with someone wanting to high five you every lap on a 2K circuit.
I don't know if that would raise your CK
level is going to go up. Is it?
No.
Matt's race there sounds like an absolute. You got caught in a barbed wire fence. You got in a fight after. I'm taking you out of the study, buddy. We cannot use you. What is going on with your life? That is hectic.
He organises the Riverhead Rampage every year. Honestly, the amount of barbed wire in it, the brawl in the pub afterwards, it's legendary. It's worth paying the entry fee for.
It's a pub brawl with a race attached to it. Really, I mean, we do things pretty wild out in Riverhead. I tell you, we don't actually. We're very vanilla. But
hey, Robbie, just circling back to the 24-hour. What did you think of Sorokin's? Have I pronounced Alexander Sorokin's record? You know, none of us expected. What do you make of it?
Well,
the 24-hour record getting Giannis's record.
Pardon? I was expecting it. I was expecting it.
Were you?
I think it was a matter. Yeah, after that 100 miler, he was so relaxed, was so controlled for the 100.
I guess when I say wasn't expecting it. He just flew up. He didn't sort of make a big song and dance about it. He just went up to, you know, went and did didn't he?
He's surpassed. This is brilliant because there's a couple of guys. There's a young guy, what's his, Taggart Van Arten or something, an American who's running big miles and he's I'm not doing much on social media, but I'm going to break all these world records. And Alexander's just like, I've done it. I've done it. Yeah, I didn't tell anyone. I've done it. That's how you do things in the 24-hour world. You've got to actually just go and run the run, right? You've got to do the things. It's very easy to do the maths on a 24-hour run and go, yeah, I can do that. I'm going to do it, guys. I'm going to talk big. Mate, just go out and do some and do what Alexander. Alexander was, there's a picture, it's on the Precision Hydration website that they use of me from the 2015 World Champs, which is great. And in the background, there's a Lithuanian vest of a man sweating and having a miserable time because he's set out fast and he's suffered. And like Alexander's ability to suffer is fantastic. And he's learned that partly through pacing some 24-hour races like an absolute moron, right? It just, like, the first few ones he just went out hard and hung on. And part of me knows that if I ever want to do that, I've got to maybe suffer as much as that man suffered in the early years of his 24-hour racing.
Right.
Because where else do you learn that, right? Like, I'm reading a book now about Polish mountaineers in the 70s and 80s, and like how are we going to learn to suffer as much as someone living in like communist Poland in the 70s? Like you can't tap into that with a load of 800 meter reps. That's not suffering. How are you going to suffer like Alexander suffers? Because, and I'm not saying he lived in Poland at that time. He just did it for 24 hour racing, and he learned to suffer. And he then took that, and then he refined his pacing. He improved his nutrition. He got definitely a boost there from the shoes that he was wearing. He was wearing the Vaporflies. Yep. But that's a very, very tiny piece of that puzzle. Mm. There aren't many people who could put on the fancy shoes and go and do what he does. And I was at UTMB. We were crewing one of my wife's athletes, and we had like 3 hours to sleep. And I got back in and someone went, have you seen Alexander's doing the 20? He's on it, mate. And I was like, right. So now I got, instead of 3 hours of sleeping, I'm going to spend 3 hours watching a live result update and just sit trickling up. And then I wrote about it. Because it doesn't get much noise and he deserves it. I've got a Lithuanian team jersey from Alexander. We swapped jerseys at one of the champs.
Oh, really?
It's just like, yeah, let's just get him to sign that in a bit.
What's he like?
As a British team, we've kind of been alongside. So in the first few years when he's pacing hard, you're like, who's this guy? And then you respect the amount he suffers, because every 24-hour champs, there's people that go out fast and just give up. That man does not give up, and it's brilliant to watch. And then he's like going around, and I'll be joking him. I think Albie in 2016, I was like, I'm going to catch you at the end, Alexander. As you come around, we have a little laugh. I'm going to get you. You're going fast. And he's lapped you like 9 times. And and then eventually I just stopped because of injury. So I didn't do that. But then you see him struggling and you want to help. Like, that's human nature. You see someone and they're underdogs, right? The Lithuanian team. You've got the other teams there and they've got full, like we as a British team have a full complement of supporters and we've got a physio and stuff. And the Lithuanians, basically, you only get crew when one of the teammates drops out. Like I think he has his brother there or something, but like they'd have like 3 runners and then one of them dropped out and then like they suddenly become the crew again and there's a bit more support. But they're very small in terms of how they're supported each time. And as he's gone through, so then in Timisoara the Worlds in 2017 in Belfast, I chatted to him before and I was like, mate, you've got to pace it more evenly. And he paced it really evenly at Belfast and he had a bad race. And he said to me afterwards, like, nah, not pacing it evenly. What are you on about? It's rubbish. But he did come the next one. He slowed down. This is what we've seen. He's still starting fast.
Yeah.
But he's got fitter. So that's still relatively easier. And he's pulled it down a notch. That means that he actually then doesn't slow down. So then like in Timisoara, he got his first medal. I think he was third in Timisoara. And it was really hot. And I was part of the support team there. So we had a load of sponges and ice for our runners. And you're seeing Alexander suffering towards the end. And I could not help, but I was like, guys, I'm going to help Alexander as well. Because he's such a nice guy. You want to help the guys put it all out there. Right, and yeah. It's kind of like, just slowly giving him sponges that we had, just kind of so he can kind of whoosh, and handed him some of the packs of ice that we're giving to our runners, because we've got enough, we've got a full team, and those guys haven't got as much as us, so it's kind of like, right, just seeing him do well that year, get that medal that he's worked so hard for, because you'd seen the blood, sweat, and tears he put into it, that was cool. And then when the next year. I'm going off on one of like an Alex, my experience of Alexander, because he's just a nice guy. But in Albi, when he won the world champs, about halfway through, they messed up the timing, right? And it took off laps from him and gave laps to the guy behind him, right? So Alexander was leading, but he wasn't on top of the leaderboard. And they were like, yeah, we're going to get it sorted. And I knew, as an athlete, the psychological impact of that could ruin your race.
And talk about your head going out.
He thought he was in second. Yeah, he might have then thought he was in second and started picking up to go again. And he's running the perfect race. And it's not, the perfect race was the one this summer. But so I then kind of got really animated and was like, no, you've got to, you either take those scores down or you correct it now or you take them off. You shut them down. Basically, it made them look bad that they messed it up. But when it's only one or two runners impacted, they don't look as bad, right? But it's the actual race. And because it was a small nation, you got the feeling that they didn't give as much of a shit about it. And it just infuriated. I love an underdog, man. And I was like, no, that boy deserves to have that taken down until you've corrected it, because otherwise you're messing with his head. Yeah. They changed it. And he had he won the world champs. And that's was that the race where we swapped jerseys? I think it was. But he's just a really nice guy. And then, to see him, the track 100 at Centurion running, when he ran that well there, and he went set the 12-hour record, you're just really pleased for him. And it's, I'm not going to lie, a little bit, there's jealousy there, because I've been racing at his level, and then he's progressed, and I've been injured, and I'm like, oh man, that could have been, and I don't know if it could have been me, but it's just nice to see someone that you know, and you've seen him do the hard miles.
Yeah.
When people ask about the performance stuff, again, he's got a lot of stuff right, and it's gone well on the day, it's the right conditions, but I've seen him do those hard miles that kind of lead you to think that's how he got there. He's a lovely bloke.
How brilliant. And he just absolutely nailed his pacing, didn't he? And, he lost his job over COVID. He's obviously put a lot of time in. Like you say, just absolutely so well-deserved.
And a beast. Andy Milroy, who's a ultra-running statistician from he's been doing it for years and years and years. We've been going back and forth on some of the splits, and it's just, what was the first one? It's basically around 3:45 to 3:58 for every 50K split.
Yeah.
It's obscenely well-paced. Monotonous. That way.
That's bananas.
Metronome, not monotonous. I suppose it might be monotonous for Alexander, but it's metronome. Watch it.
It's just, oh my goodness. Look, Robbie, your coffee's probably gone cold. You've interrupted your Sunday morning for us, and we really, really appreciate that. But before we let you go, where can people find your book?
So I know that that's a Vertebrate Publishing. You can pre-order it there now. I was excited to see it. It's on Amazon. If you can find it, if you go to your local bookshop, I think they can order it in and stuff. So that's just, maybe it's better to support your local bookshops than to sign up to help a man get into space. But I went on Waterstones. Yeah, you're gonna have to remove that. And you can't say that.
No.
You can't say that. It's like naming the podcast.
I've said it.
Damn.
And we stand with you. We're standing.
There are
Amazon.
Good places to buy books. I use, you can't help but use Amazon, can you? It was on Waterstones and W.H. Smith, which are very, I don't know if they're just, they're British bookstores, but they're bookstores that I spent hours in as a child. So I saw it on the W.H. Smith and the Waterstones website, and I was like, I used to get a £5 book token from my nan every, we got it once a month. And most of my cousins would go in there and just if I buy this magazine, I get more change and I can buy sweets. And I'd be like, right, what's on the 2 for a 5 deal? What can I get? I mean, you imagine getting a book for £5 now, but you can't. But I would go around and I'd spend hours kind of just worrying I was getting the wrong one. And like, I just loved being in there. And I'd have read half the book by the time I'd like chosen which one I was going to get and wandering around. So I can't wait to actually go. I've not seen a copy of the book yet, but some of the people reviewing, doing early reviews, have got it and they're sending me a picture. And I'm like, I haven't touched a book yet. With someone else has got a sample copy. But so, yeah, you can get it online. And I hope they a vertebrate, they do ship worldwide. Just takes a little longer to get to where
some kid
are.
Somewhere is going to be going in with a voucher from their nan.
Absolutely.
And buying
not
buying
being
your
able
book.
To afford that book.
Unless it's risen with
Unless
inflation.
It's super, yeah, hopefully. Hopefully people are getting £20 book tokens these days.
That's right. Look, Robbie, thank you so much for coming on again. We really appreciate it. And I hope your race goes well next week.
Fingers crossed. I mean, what's the worst that can happen? I get to cycle around southern Italy, eat some lovely food, and I might end up crying again. But like, you learn something about yourself. And when's the 24-hour race for Eugene?
Well, 4 weeks, hopefully, depending
four weeks.
On lockdown restrictions. Mm.
Cool. Yep. And I know you guys probably got to go, but like, have you got a nutrition plan built up yet? Are you thinking about that? Have you been practicing it?
Yeah, I've been really working on my nutrition during my longer training runs, which is, cool. I'm happy.
That's going to be one of the main factors involved in 24-hour running.
Yeah.
Eating, drinking, and smiling as much as you can.
Yeah. Now I'm looking forward to it.
Nice.
Brilliant. Thanks, Robbie.
I really love how he goes from like, of his kind of anecdotes, and then all of a sudden he's just like nerding out about like academic research. It's quite disarming, you know, like.
Oh, but it's, you know, you're talking to someone who really knows their stuff, don't you?
Yeah.
And what a great person to write a book of running tips.
Absolutely. I am legitimately looking forward to some running books. You're like, okay, it's another running book. I'm really looking forward to getting my hands on this one, and
absolutely.
Yeah, I hope he'll be immersed in his cycle race across Sicily as this goes to air. So, yeah, I hope that you're having a good time, and I really liked his sort of call to action to support your local bookseller.
Totally.
So,
absolutely.
All so right. Good to be back.
Yes.
And it's great
good
seeing
to you,
man. Brother. Yeah,
it
absolutely.
Yeah.
And thank you to all of you for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio, and you can email us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. You can find us on all the podcast platforms. Like and subscribe if you fancy, and you can download direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio.com.
Don't forget to write in with your greatest run ever. We'd love to hear from you, and you can read them on the website. There is a little bit of a backlog because a bunch of people sent in lockdown ones, which is brilliant, but keep them coming in.
Absolutely. Thanks to our sponsors, Scott Running, Further Faster, and CLE. Thank you to our Patreon patrons and Wild Things. Thank you to our editor, Kieran. It's great to be back, and we've got a great show lined up for you next week. So tune in then.
Ka kite anō. Thanks, Rigby.